So after bolted connection, let's see another method of connecting these structural members in steel design, and that is welded connections. So why do we choose welded connections sometimes over the bolted connection? The reason is the structure becomes lighter. There are many reasons. One of them is structure becomes lighter because in case of bolted connection, we have to use gusset plate to connect the different members, and this weight of the gusset plate increases the weight of the whole structure. Whereas in case of welded connection, we can directly weld these two members, so the requirement of this gusset plate is over. The other point is the efficiency. What we can achieve here is 100%. It means whatever is the strength of parent member or the member what we are connecting, whatever the strength of that member, we can achieve the same strength with our welded connection also. Whereas in case of bolted connection, the highest efficiency can only be 70 to 80%. There are some disadvantages also. In case of bolted connection, we can do some changes. We can open the bolt, and if some changes are required, then we can connect another member, or whatever the change is required, we can do that. Whereas in case of welded connection, no change is possible after the construction has been done. So if there has been some mistake, we cannot change that. So you can see these advantages and disadvantages in detail in some book. I'll just move to the design part. So for the welds, we have three type of welds, that is butt weld, fillet weld, slot and plug weld. In butt weld, what we do, we take the two plates and place them back to back, and this part we'll do the welding. So if this end is square shape, then it is called as the square butt weld. Square butt weld. And if we have done the welding on only one side, then it is square butt weld on one side. Similarly, if we have done the welding on both the sides, then it is called a square butt weld on both sides. So there are other possible shapes also on joints, that is single V butt weld, that is like this. If we have done, then it is single V, and similarly we can obtain double V also. So this is, we'll do the welding on both the sides, then it is double V. So similarly you can obtain single U, double U, single J, double J, and single bevel. So all those, if you want to see, you can check in some book. So I just want to tell, but what will be the change in single V or double V, or single side or double side? So in single type, what happens, this part of the metals or this part of the plates, it is not welded together. So here we say the depth of penetration is not complete, or we call it as incomplete penetration joint. Incomplete penetration. Whereas these double V, double U, all these joints are complete penetration joints. So we'll see in the design how does it affect. So after the butt weld, next we have fillet weld. So in fillet weld is used basically when we have two surfaces which are at some angle. That is, if we want to connect this surface and this surface, so here we'll do the welding. That is called as our fillet weld. And in case of lap joint also, if we want to make the connection like this, so we'll do the welding on this surface and here on this surface, and that is our lap joint with fillet weld. So in this case, there are some terminology. So this part of the joint, it is called as the root of the fillet. This part and this part is called as the toe of the joint. And apart from that, this length or this length is called as the leg size. So apart from fillet weld, we have slot and plug weld also. So in that case, what we do, if we have two plates here that we want to connect, so in slot weld, we'll cut a let's say a circular shape here or circular hole on one plate, and we'll do the welding on this periphery here. This will be a fillet weld, but the way it is done, so it is called as the slot weld. Similarly, if we are making some small holes and then we are completely filling it with welding material, or we can say we are plugging this hole, then it is called as the plug weld. So after that, code has given some specifications for these welds that we'll see. So I've just taken the important ones here, what we'll use mostly in the design. First is for the butt weld. So the first one is, the size of butt weld shall be specified by the effective throat thickness. So the size of weld what we are going to take, it is called, or it is defined with some term which is known as throat thickness or the effective throat thickness. Now how do we find out this throat thickness? So for that, the code says, in case of complete penetration butt weld, so what already we have seen, what is complete penetration butt weld? So double V, double U, all those are complete penetration butt weld, where this hole, these two, both the metals are completely in contact with each other and with this welded material. So in case of complete penetration weld, the effective throat thickness shall be taken as thickness of thinner part. So if this is T1 and T2, these two thicknesses of the plate, then we'll find out the throat thickness as, because in our design we'll always use the throat thickness of the weld, so we need to find out the throat thickness. So for the butt weld with complete penetration, it is taken as the thickness of thinner plate. So that is about the complete penetration. And if it is incomplete penetration, then the code says, the butt weld shall be taken as minimum thickness of weld metal common to the parts joined. So incomplete penetration, for example, we can take single V joint. So in this case, the code says that the effective throat thickness shall be taken as the minimum thickness of weld metal common to the parts. So from here or here, whatever is the minimum thickness which is common to both the parts, that the code says should be taken as throat thickness. But mostly for your use in some exam, it will not be given that whatever is this common thickness. So the code says that if in the absence of data, it means if nothing is given, you can take the throat thickness in case of incomplete penetration, it is equal to 5 by 8 times T minimum. In T minimum, we'll find out the minimum thickness of these two plates. So that is about the size of the weld, or which we define using the throat thickness, size of weld. And now we multiplied this throat thickness with effective length is nothing but the length for which we are providing this throat thickness. So size of the weld multiplied by the effective thickness gives us the area of the weld, and if we multiply it by the stress which we are allowing in our weld, then we can obtain the strength of this joint. So that's how we calculate the strength. So the next provision says that the effective length of butt weld shall be taken as length of full size weld. So it means that for the length we are providing this throat thickness, that will be our effective length. So this we'll see in detail when we solve some example. The minimum length of butt weld shall be 4 times the size of the weld. So minimum length, or we are talking about this length, so if this is our butt weld, in the plan if we make, so here we'll do the welding. So it says that this minimum length, if say it is L, then L minimum is equal to 4 times the size of weld. So size of weld is defined using some throat thickness. So depending upon that, 4 times of size of weld we'll say is our L minimum. After that, next says if intermittent welding is used, it shall have an effective length of not less than 4 times the weld size, and spacing between the two welds shall not be more than 16 times the thickness of thinner part. So first of all, what is intermittent weld? So if this length is too much, if these plates are too long, then we'll do, and the welding requirement is not as much, so we'll do this welding in parts. We leave some space here, and that is our intermittent weld. So for that, it says that it shall have an effective length of not less than 4 times the weld size. So whatever is the weld size, this total length, if we are calculating this, so if it is L1, L2, L3, then L1 plus L2 plus L3 should be at least 4 times the size of weld. And after that, it says that this spacing is there, it should not be more than 16 times the thickness of thinner part. So this spacing, if we say is L dash, then L dash max is equal to 16 times the T minimum. T minimum is the thickness of thinner plate. So that is about the butt weld. So for the fillet weld, next it says for the size of the fillet weld, we have the size of the normal fillet weld shall be taken as the minimum weld leg size. So size of the fillet weld, it says it is this leg size is this size. So this is our size of the fillet weld. So here also we will try to find out the throat thickness, because in design we will always use throat thickness. So that we will see in a minute. Before that, we have for deep penetration welds with penetration not less than 2.4 mm, size of weld is minimum leg size plus 2.4 mm. So what does this deep penetration weld means? So what happens in welding, when we are connecting these two plates, there are some methods. So when we'll connect here, so this part of the metal or this part of the two plates, it is also affected. So we say this is also fused together, so this has also welded. So this is our extra penetration what we are achieving. So in this case, if it is like this, if we have weld only like this, then this is taken as the throat thickness, whereas if we have deep penetration, then this should be our actual throat thickness. It means our weld size has also been increased. So for that, it says the weld size, let's say S is the weld size, then it is taken as the minimum leg size. So whatever is the leg size, let's say T plus 2.4 mm, that would be your weld size. And for fillet welds by semi-automatic or automatic processes with deep penetration more than 2.4 mm, the purchaser and contractor agree. So if the purchaser and contractor agree, then they can take the size of the fillet as minimum leg size plus actual penetration. But this penetration is very difficult to control. This part of the weld, it is difficult to control and measure. And for our use, what all questions we are going to solve here, it will mostly not come into use. After that, the next one is the minimum size of fillet weld specified is 3 mm, so we cannot provide lesser than 3 mm. And depending upon the plate size, we have some other recommendation also. So if the plate size is less than 10 mm, it is 3 mm. For 10 to 20 mm, it is 5 mm. 20 to 32 mm, it is 6 mm. And for 32 to 50, it is 8 mm for first run and 10 for minimum size of weld. So the minimum size here is 10 mm, similar to here it is 3, 5, 6, it is 10 mm, but the 10 we will not provide in only one go. What we'll do, we'll provide first as 8 mm, then we'll provide over this weld, we'll provide one more time, and then we'll keep it as minimum of 10 mm. Whereas because these are smaller values, and Because of that reason, we can simply provide in one time. That is 3 mm, we can provide. Similarly, 5 mm, 6 mm. But if it is the plate size is bigger than 32 mm, then first we have to provide at 8, then we have to provide a total minimum of 10. That is about the fillet size. So how do we calculate the throat thickness from this? So it shall not be less than 3 mm. The throat thickness, if you are talking about the minimum throat thickness is 3 mm, it should not generally exceed 0.7 t or t in special circumstances. So how, as I said, this length here, if these are the two plates connected here, so this length is taken as the throat thickness. So how have we obtained this point T? Let's say if this is A and this length is A, then you can find out from this triangle. If you take, then you can find out that this length comes out to be A by root 2, and which is approximately equal to 707 A. And that's what we use here. This T is nothing but this leg size here that we take as T. So we take the 0.7 times T, and that is our throat thickness. And in some special circumstances, that is if we are using some deep penetration weld, in some other cases we can take it as T, but not more than that. So that is about throat thickness. So in our case, mostly we'll use 0.7 times T, and it should not be less than 3 mm also. This criteria is also should be kept in mind. So this 0.7 t is the factor when we have used the angle between 60 to 90 degrees. This angle between the two plates is between 60 to 90 degrees. If some other angle is there, then this value of 0.7 is replaced. So if it is 91 to 100 degrees, it is 0.65. For 101 to 106, it is 0.6, and similarly, so on. Next point is about the effective length. So here it says, what we do in our design, we provide one weld length and which is greater than effective length. So let's understand that. So weld length is equal to effective length plus twice the weld size. So if S is the size of the weld, then the actual weld length for which we'll do the welding is equal to effective length plus 2S. So let's say from our design, this is the length of weld we find out, and that would be our L effective. But we'll provide the weld length more than this. So from at both the ends, we'll extend this weld up to what distance? Up to a distance of weld size, that is S. So L effective plus 2S is equal to weld length here. Now for this part, it is required that we consider the thickness or the weld size is equal to throat thickness. But for this end part, we can change that. It is not required, but for this part it is necessary, or it is mandatory, that we provide the throat thickness as the weld size. That's what is written here. After that, one more thing is there, is effective length should not be less than 4 times the size of the weld. So this cannot be less than 4 times the size of the weld, or 4 times the throat thickness, because size of the weld we always take as the throat thickness. So after that, we have for lap joint, the minimum lap should be 4 times the thickness of thinner part joint or 40 mm. So in lap joint, we'll overlap these two plates. So for this overlap, it says this overlap here, if it is L dash, then this L dash minimum, the minimum of value of this L dash is equal to maximum of, let's say this is T1 and T2. So from that, we'll find out the T minimum. So it is 4 times T minimum and 40 mm. So using this criteria, we'll find out the minimum value of overlap in case of lap joint. Other things are same what we are doing for fillet joint, fillet weld, because in case of lap joint we provide fillet weld. So all the specifications which are there for fillet weld, will be there in lap joint. So for fillet weld, if there are some more left, if a fillet weld is to the square edge of a part, the specified size of the weld should generally be at least 1.5 mm less than the edge thickness. So if this is our fillet weld, because this is our square edge here, so we'll provide the weld like this. Here we'll keep a minimum gap of 1.5 mm. That is the meaning here. After that, it says if a fillet weld is to the rounded toe of a rolled section, that is, if in rolled section we generally have this rounded toe here, so if it is connected like this, so we'll do the fillet welding here, then this thickness of fillet weld, if it is T here, then it can only be 3 by 4 into T max, this thickness. So after that, we have in members subjected to dynamic loading, the fillet weld shall be of full size with leg length equal to thickness of plate. So if we are facing dynamic loading in the structure, then this 1.5 reduction is not required. We will provide the fillet weld for full size, and this leg size or this leg length is equal to this thickness of plate. So these are about the criteria. Now there is one reduction factor also, reduction in design stress for long joint. So if there is a long joint, how we define the long joint? If the length of joint or length of the welded joint is greater than 150 times T, T is the throat thickness, then we call it to be a long joint. So if reduction in design stress for long joint, so the formula for this reduction or the reduction factor which is multiplied to the design stress is given as 1.2 minus 0.2 lj divided by 150 t, and it should not greater than 1, it is less than equal to 1, so which is only applied if the length of joint is greater than 150 t. So if the length of joint is greater than this, so the code considers that if the length of joint exceeds 150 t, the distribution of stresses in the welding joint or the welded joint, it becomes non-uniform, and due to this non-uniform distribution, some part of the weld becomes ineffective in the resistance. So for that, we provide some reduction factor. Now how do we go for the design? So as I said, we find out the effective area, or the effective area is given as effective length times the throat thickness gives us the effective area of the weld, effective area of weld. Now we multiply it by the design stress, or the design stress what we allow in the material. So that design stress F welding design is given as Fu by root 3 divided by gamma mw. Gamma mw is the partial safety factor. It is 1.25 for shop welds, and it is 1.5 for field welds, because in field that accuracy is not achieved or precision is not achieved. So for that, we take the partial safety factor as 1.5. So we'll calculate the stress using this formula. We'll multiply the stress with this area, and that gives us the design strength of the joint. So let's see one small example for here. After that, I'll take more examples. So if we have two plates, one is of 18 mm thickness, another is of 16 mm thickness, and the weld's length is given. So the L effective of weld is given as 200 mm. So we have to find out the strength of joint. Strength of joint First case is if a double V butt weld is used, and the second case is a single V butt weld is used. Single V butt weld is used. So as I said, strength of the joint, how will we find? So stress we take as Fu by under root 3. If we are considering it to be a shop weld, then gamma Mw is equal to 1.25. So this is our stress which is permissible, multiplied by the L effective, multiplied by the throat thickness. So this gives us the design strength. Now for the double V weld, what is the throat thickness? So we saw in the specification that for the complete penetration, double V is a complete penetration type joint. So for that, throat thickness is the thickness of thinner plate, and that here is we have two plates, one is of 18 mm thickness, another is of 16 mm thickness. So thickness of thinner plate is equal to 16 mm, and effective length is also given, that is 200 mm. So from here we can calculate the strength of the joint as Fu by under root 3, 1.25, L effective is 200, and throat thickness is 16 mm. Now for the Fu, it is the ultimate stress. We take ultimate stress either of the plate or welding material, whichever is minimum. Now if nothing is given, then it will be given for the plate mostly. So here we are considering the Fe410 plate. So for that we will take this design's ultimate stress as 410 MPa. So putting all these values here, we calculate the strength of the joint, and it comes out as 605.9 kN, dividing it by 1000. Also, that is for a single V joint. Instead, if we have used, sorry, it is for a double V joint. Instead, if we have used single V joint, then this throat thickness will change. So for the incomplete penetration, throat thickness, as I said, for a butt weld, it is equal to 5/8 times T minimum, which is equal to 5/8 times 16 mm, and that is equal to 10 mm here. So here again we can simply put the same values, 410 divided under root 3, 1.25 multiplied by 200, that is L effective. Throat thickness here is 10 mm, dividing it by 1000 for kilonewton. And so from here we get the strength of the joint as 378.742 kN. So here you can see, if we are using incomplete penetration, then this strength is almost reduced to the half. So we'll see some more examples on this after this video.